There is one additional nice thing about Hoyne's method. It gives us Hoyne's estimate for the next step. And in parallel, we get Euler's estimate for free. And we can compare these estimates to find out the error that we are making. By the way, the technical term for this type of method is an embedded Runge-Kutta method, if you want to look that up. Remember the two types of errors I introduced before. The one type of error that we're actually interested in the end, is the GTE, the global truncation error. By how far are we off after a finite time? What Hoyne's method allows us is to estimate the LTE, the local truncation error, the error that we are making at each step. Consider the distance between the Euler result for that step and the Hoyne result for that step. As we saw earlier, Hoyne's result is much more accurate than Euler's result. So what we see here is about the error of Euler's method, the LTE of Euler's method. I'm cheating a little here. I must take the velocity into account. Of course, we have several dimensions, two dimensions concerning x and two dimensions concerning velocity. We have to take all of them into account. So we need this term as well. By how far is the Euler estimate for the velocity off from Hoyne's estimate? You could simply form the sum here, but that would look strange for physicists. These are meters per second. That does not work. The most simple idea is to introduce a time in here, end time of that simulation. And that makes sense. When the velocity is off by a certain amount early in that simulation, that error will grow over the course of that simulation. There's other ways of combining these differences. You could form the square here, the square there, and then take the square root. But to make things simple, I'm simply using this distance plus the simulation time times that distance. We know that the GTE, the global truncation error, for Euler's method is a constant times the step size. One can also show that the local truncation error is another constant times the step size squared. You can check the plausibility of h squared appearing here. If I double the step size, I only need half as many steps. Each step has four times the error. I need half as many steps, which means that the total error is multiplied by 2, which we know is the case. What I can do now is to change the step size as I go. I do not need to specify the step size in advance. Hoyne's method is able to estimate the perfect step size for a given accuracy. Assume that I did the first step with some step size, whichever one I chose. But what I want is that this error, the local truncation error of Euler's method, is of a fixed size. Let's call that tolerance. What I want is to find a step size, let's call it h nu, so that this error is of the fixed size called tolerance, which would be measured in meters, by the way, with this type of error. I can compute c from that very first step. It would be the local truncation error divided by h square old, and I can solve for the new step size. So the method actually determines the right step size I should be taking, given the tolerance. I can solve for the new step size and find that the new step size is the old step size times the square root of the tolerance divided by this local truncation error that I can compute numerically. So after we did the first step with that old step size, we got an estimate for a perfect step size that would produce a local truncation error of size tolerance for Euler's method. And we can keep doing that as we go. The step size will be adjusted automatically. We do not have to worry about it. The method will choose the step size for us. One benefit of this method choosing the perfect step size for us is that we do not have to choose it up front. The other benefit is that the solution will be stepping at appropriate step sizes. For instance, when we come closer to a planet and the trajectory gets more bent, we need more steps. This method will automatically choose smaller steps as we go and eventually use larger steps again.